Ukraine is skeptical about Russia's promise to scale down military operations around Kyiv. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky says his people are not naive and that they have learned to only trust concrete results. Russia's one-month-old invasion has been halted on most fronts by stiff Ukrainian resistance, who have recaptured some territories. The Pentagon has also confirmed Russia has started moving a small number of troops away from Kyiv, but it says this is more of a repositioning than a retreat. The U.S. warns the threat to Kyiv is not yet over. Russia and Ukraine making their most significant progress yet in the peace talks as both sides offered proposals that could lead to a meeting between their leaders. Let's get more details in this report.
Ukraine negotiators say they offered to adopt a neutral status in exchange for security guarantees on Tuesday, a step that marked the most significant progress in talks to date. The proposal followed the first face-to-face meetings with Russia in nearly 3 weeks. Ukraine says it would not join military alliances or host military bases, but proposed its security would be guaranteed by similar terms to NATO's Article 5 Collective Defense Clause. Kyiv identified Israel and NATO members Canada, Poland and Turkey as countries that could help provide such guarantees. The Ukraine proposals also include a 15-year consultation period on the status of annexed Crimea, but they could only come into force following a complete ceasefire. Ukrainian negotiator David Arachamia.
In order for this agreement to be valid and for all sides to agree on it, there has to be full peace on Ukraine's territory. No foreign troops, all have to leave. Our proposition has not been accepted by Russia yet. We are just handing it over to the Russian side today. We are saying, this is our position. We are giving you our official position. And then we will wait for their answer.
Ukrainian television reported the face-to-face talks in Istanbul began with a cold welcome. But their resumption is seen as an important step towards a ceasefire. Ukrainian negotiators believe the new proposals are sufficient to warrant a meeting between Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky and Russian President Vladimir Putin. Russia is yet to respond to that, but Moscow did confirm it would drastically cut its military activity around Kyiv and Chernihiv to create the conditions for dialogue. All that came just hours after a Russian rocket hit the regional administration building in Mykolaiv earlier on Tuesday, killing at least 3 people and wounding others, according to the local authorities. Video showed a large hole in the side of a building. Mykolaiv is among the southern port cities standing in the way of Russia establishing a land corridor to Crimea. Heavily bombed Mariupol shares that fate.
We had a beautiful life, just beautiful. Now we have nothing, just nothing.
Russia calls its actions in Ukraine a special operation that it says is not designed to occupy territory, but to destroy its southern neighbor's military capabilities and capture what it regards as dangerous nationalists. The West says Russia launched an unprovoked war.
The war has sparked voluntarism among Ukrainians who chose to stay home. Take a look.
In the besieged Ukrainian city of Kharkiv, so far one of the hardest hit by Russia's invasion of the country, volunteers Maxim and Sergei are helping residents survive by distributing humanitarian aid. Walking through the eastern neighborhood of Kharazont, they hand out food and medicine to those who remain.
People lost their homes, their flats. Many were hit by bombs, by rockets. There is almost no life in the district.
We are here to make sure that not a single person is hungry or dies of starvation. That would be horrible. Apart from this, we help with medicine as much as we can, whatever we can order. Plus, we help the elderly and the bedridden. We deliver personal hygiene products. There are quite a few children and babies in the district. We deliver baby food for them.
Grassroots and self-funded charities have delivered food, medicine and personal hygiene products to residents who are unable to get humanitarian aid because of old age, disability or their neighbourhood being under regular shelling. Vitaly is one of Kharkiv's residents reliant on the help of volunteers.
I used to help blind people. I organized cultural trips to Kyiv, to theaters, so that people who are blind could widen their knowledge. Now I'm very grateful for Sergei and his team's help. They help us, the disabled, a lot. They bring whatever you ask for. They bring water.
The United States forging ahead on its growing Asia-Pacific priorities despite the crisis sparked by Russia's invasion on Ukraine. In a meeting with Singapore's Prime Minister at the White House, U.S. President Joe Biden said his administration remains committed to its Indo-Pacific strategy. Under the policy, the U.S. vows to commit more diplomatic and security resources to counter what it sees as China's bid to create a regional sphere of influence.
Matter of fact, things are growing important. And a rule-based order is facing unprecedented challenges. Russia's unprovoked and unjustifiable war against Ukraine is an urgent threat to both Europe and, I believe, to the Indo-Pacific as well. And it's attacking the core tenets of a rule-based international order. Borders can't be changed by force, and all the nations, large and small, are equal and sovereign in the right for their sovereignty.
Singapore hopes that the United States, amidst all its many preoccupations, will continue to deepen its relationship with countries in Asia Pacific, China certainly, but also other countries besides China, and deepen it substantially in many different ways through the Indo-Pacific strategy, and in doing so, to foster the peace, stability, and security of the region, as you have done for so many decades since the war.
Biden had been due to host leaders of the 10-nation Association of Southeast Asian Nations this week, but the summit was postponed because not all leaders could be in attendance.